On behalf of Equestrian Canada, we welcome everyone to the webinar this evening. We hope you find this webinar both enjoyable and entertaining. Those not familiar with the Zoom features, we ask that you mute your line to avoid any background interference during the session. If you wish to submit a question during the session, please do so using the Q&A feature, which you should be able to find at the bottom of your screen in the toolbar. We do ask that you not use the chat, as it can be distracting to our presenter. As we have a lot of people joining us this evening, patience if we experience any technical difficulties. Without further ado, I introduce you to Jamie Ann Goodfellow, the program coordinator for the Para-Dressage program, as she presents our video competition series.
Thank you and welcome. Our webinar is on Para-Dressage Video Competition, bringing the competition to you. Thank you for joining us this evening. Next slide, Slim. Grace, this year our video competitions has been sponsored by Ride Every Stride, so a portion of the gift certificates that we have that for the prizes for second and third is provided by Ride Every Stride, and the High Point Championships at the end of the season will be sponsored from Ride Every Stride. Next. What is Para-Dressage Video Competition Series? So it provides riders with all levels and abilities the opportunity to experience competition conditions in the comfort of their own home stable on a familiar horse. It encourages riders to develop effective skills and provide them with opportunity to compete in structured environment. It encourages athletes to develop effective skills. It also it's an opportunity to compete in structured environment. Next slide. Para-Dressage Video Competitions. Participant riders can video themselves performing a dressage test offered a number of different tests that we offer, and they upload them through the online portal through the EC website. And they have an opportunity to win prizes and ribbons. And then at the end of the year, like I mentioned before, we have a High Point Championship and High Point Riding Center. Next slide. Who is eligible to compete within the video competition? We have a series of anybody, so riders with intellectual or physical disability are eligible to compete in the video competition. You do not need to be classified to compete within the video competition. It's a great opportunity to get your feet riders an opportunity to experience competitions in the comfort of their own stables. Next slide, Slim. This year, for 2020, we've offered a number of new tests. So we have freestyle tests that are RDA freestyle tests that are new. So they're EC national level tests that we're offering. And it's a great opportunity for athletes to work with their coaches and provide, get creative and pick some music. And there's mandatory movements within the test, the level of test that you choose, but it kind of lets you get creative on with your music and your freestyle. We're also, we have the FEI Para-Dressage Introductory Test A and B for all grades have been added for this season. So there's many different types of tests that you can pick with your coach, personal coach, and whatever for your development level. Next slide. So putting the test to music. So like I mentioned, within our Para-Dressage 2020 competition guidelines, on page 6 of the guidelines, we have some guidelines on choosing music and design for designing for freestyle tests. If it's a first time that you've never experienced putting a freestyle together, there's some tips and tricks within the guidelines that I would recommend people reference. Next slide. Filming your video tips and tricks. So you can see within this video here, there basically when reviewing, make sure that you can see the athlete's position. The horse are, so if you can see within this video, it's very blurry and it's distorted. So when the judge is judging the video, they need to see the full position of the athlete throughout the frame, the horse and rider throughout the frame of the test, so they can judge the video. When you film the competition entry, set the camera for the whole horse remains within the frame for as much of the video as possible. Try to keep the horse in the center of the frame when you film behind C. Other recommendations is using a tripod versus, or if you don't have a tripod, maybe brace your, so you can lean against something so then your arm's not moving. Another recommendation is always film with the sun to the back of you so there's not a glare coming through on the video. Or is hard to see when the glare is coming through for the judge to actually see the rider's form. Other pointers, recommendations is you can reference the guidelines within the video competitions. It has tips and tricks and recommendations on filming your video entry. Next slide, Flynn. So you can see, so this is another video, just a filming example. So you can see how much clearer this video is. We won't go into the video, but it's you can see how clear it is just from the snapshot of it. You can see the full frame of the horse and the rider for the video. Next slide, Flynn. So I'm just going to go over a little bit about the Para-Dressage video competition portal and just do a quick review and then we can answer any questions if anybody has at the end. So next slide, Lynn. So when you log into the video competition portal, you need a username and password. You can access through a link on the Para-Dressage website. In order to compete within the video competitions, you have to have a valid Equestrian Canada sport license. And in order for a coach, if an athlete does not want to, is unable to submit their entry and they want their coach to submit on their behalf, the coach needs to fill out a page 13 within the guidelines, and it's a registration form to confirm that they can, they are able to submit on their behalf, and there's a waiver there giving them permission to be able to do that. Next slide, Flynn. So this is a little bit of a snapshot of what you see and the different steps that's required within submitting your video competition entries. So first step, you need to select your category, select your test, add your YouTube link, enter your coach name, enter your riding center, your name of your horse is step 6, enter who observed the test, so who actually was filming your test, read the athlete waiver and sign it, so by clicking the box, and then read and waive the waiver that you've posted your video with your entries. There's two waivers that you need to complete. If the coach is filling it out on your behalf, the waiver that you submit at the start of the season, that is those waivers. So you're saying that you agree that for the whole season that your coach can submit on your behalf. And then you need to register. Next slide, Flynn. So this is just by selecting category of the test, you'll have a drop-down menu. So this is just another snapshot of what you see when you look at when you're going into each subcategory when you're filling in the entry. Next slide. You must select a category in the test. So you pick your category and then you pick your test. And then you can see more of a detailed information from the previous slide of what information is required. You'll be required when you fill in your, submit your entry to a YouTube URL link. Please note, we'll go into the next slide, but please note that we recommend that you submit your, when you do your video of submitting your YouTube link, we recommend that you do unlisted. Unlisted means that only whoever you share your link with has access to it, unless you prefer, you want to have it on a public domain and you want people to view it. But if you check unlisted, then only whoever you share that link with will have access to your video. Next slide. So this is pretty basically what it said. So recommending how to, within the guidelines, we also have a little bit of information on how to create a YouTube account if you've never done it before. And it'll guide you through on how to create that YouTube link. Okay, next slide, Lynn. Once you submit your, once you put your YouTube link, you can preview your video. So where the eye is here, you can see watch your video. So you can just do a quick snapshot of your video to make sure it's clear. You can have the horse and the rider is in full view of the whole video. So it's just a quick preview to make sure that everything you have, and also that you have the correct video that you've submitted. You might have uploaded the wrong link by accident. So you can just do a quick check to make sure it's the right one. Next slide. So this is a snapshot of what you would see when you're previewing the option to, it'll pop up and you can actually see your video there. Next slide. So when you're completing your registration, the last part is you just need to register. Once you've registered, you will receive, you submit your video. Next slide. You'll get thank you for submitting it and a confirmation. Myself at the office at Question Canada, I will receive a message from the online submission that somebody submitted their video entry. At that point in time, when the video competition entry date comes up, I work with Entry Secretary Liz Smith, and she supports me, and we review all the videos just to make sure that everybody has submitted for the test that they submitted. They're a right match. If not, then we'll go in and make sure that we will change those around, or we'll contact the athlete and ask them any questions if the video is not clear, or ask any questions. Next. And you'll be able to, so once the video competition, the entries, the results have been submitted and gone out, there's an opportunity that you can go online and there's a list of videos. So you can go online and review your test online. So at this link here, you can, it has access to view all your video submissions, and you can watch your test live, and have at the same time on the right hand side of your screen, you'll be able to see the judge remarks as you're watching the video. So it's a great little tool that maybe an athlete and coach can get together and watch it together and look at the remarks and to there's also an opportunity, you do get a hard copy test sheet, but it's a live option that you can do with your coach and watch and just have discussions. It's a great training tool. Next slide. So at the end of about 2 weeks after each video competition deadline, we will send out the competition results. When we submit the results, send out the results, they are sent out via Equestrian Canada contact list. If you're not receiving any para-dressage communications, you can contact me in the office and I can send you the link to get added to that list. When we send out the results, we have the class number, the placings, the rider's name, the horse's name, the therapeutic or riding center, the province where they're representing, and the score. So we send those out within the results. And if you click on the rider's name, the video for their test will appear. So it's a live link to their videos. When you're registering for your video competition, part of the waiver that you submit is that Equestrian Canada can share and use that footage for the purposes of sharing on their website. Next slide. So like I mentioned at the beginning, so the prizes are generously sponsored by Ride Every Stride. They are provided to the top three finishes in each of the class. Competitors receive electronic copy of the judges' scores and comments. We do send out ribbons as well for the first top three. Next slide. This is what we reviewed earlier. So this is where you can review your remarks at the top of your screen for when the athlete videos. So after you get your test results, you can go in there and see the live remarks. And so this is a snapshot of what you see when you're reviewing your remarks. On the left-hand side of the screen is the test, and then the right-hand side of the screen is the movement, the mark, and remarks from the judge. And then at the bottom of the screen, you'll see any additional remarks from the judge. You have an option, you can print it from there, but you will receive a hard copy with your entry, the results of the competition. And that is for my presentation. I'd like to open up the floor to see if there's any questions.
So yes, we do have a number of questions coming forward to you for this evening, Jamie Ann. The first is, when is the next opportunity to compete?
So the next video competition deadline is coming up August 15th. So due to COVID, we had two competitions, which were held February and March, and then they were postponed for a period of time. July was the first one that we had coming back. We were fortunate to be able to add three additional dates that were original on our roster. So we had July added, August, and then September. So we have August is coming up, August 15th at midnight. That's the deadline to submit your entries. And then we also have September and October added to.
So the next question that we had was concerning, where do we find all the information about these on the website?
So if you, on the website, if you go to para-dressage under disciplines, under programs, there is, and when you scroll down under programs, it's under video competitions. The actual para-dressage competition series competitor guidelines, and that is where you would be able to find out all the rules, the dates, the classes available, and that's if that you can't find it on the website, please contact me at the office, jgoodfellow@equestriancanada.ca, and I'm happy to send you a copy of the information.
So I'm just going to take a look at what we have next in our series of questions for you, Jamie Ann. So is there a dress code for competitors?
So for the video competitions, we do not have there isn't a dress code. We encourage people to not wear loose, so tight-fitting clothes with the joggers, so the judge can see your riding position. So not wearing a loose-fitting coat or something. So we want them to be able to see your full position. But you do not have to wear a show jacket. Just boots with joggers and a polo shirt or a form-fitting top, so they can see your riding position.
And Jamie Ann, maybe if you could explain as well to those that have joined us tonight, perhaps some of the equipment that would or would not be permitted to be on the horse. I'm thinking of bandages and that sort of thing. Perhaps you could give folks a quick little overview on that, please.
So if you have any questions regarding the equipment, what's allowed and what's not allowed, I definitely would, depending on what I recommend you reviewing the guidelines and then reference EC rules. So dressage rules, there's a section for para-dressage within there. So those would be the two. For the video competitions, we use the EC section rules.
So I'll just take another quick look. Thank you for the questions. So for riders looking up their tests, does the website retain their tests from previous years?
I would have to look into that. I believe it's only for the season. I would have to contact my programmer on that. So if whoever's inquiring on that, if you could send me inquiry to the office and I can look into that. I believe it's only for for the season that they're available online.
Okay, and we'll move along to our next question. So if you have a rider who tends to talk out loud through their test, will they be penalized in any way?
I would have to, for the video competitions, I don't believe that they would, I would have to reference the rules, but if it's a verbal person and they're entering in under the intellectual category, I don't believe that they would be penalized for that, but I would have to reference the rules on that.
And our next question is with regards to sidewalkers and asking if they would be permitted or not.
Yes, so sidewalkers are permitted within the video competitions. You have to, within the guidelines, it goes into what classes they're available. I believe it's the introductory, the first tests that they're available. There's guidelines on the rules for the sidewalkers on their, there's guidelines on where they need to walk. So they're not blocking the rider, the view of the rider. So, and they're not they're not directing the horse. So the horse is, within their guidelines, please reference that. And it's because there's safety concerns on where the sidewalkers are. So please reference the guidelines.
Okay. And how many rides per competition are you able to submit by each rider?
So within the competitions, you can enter in one or only in one class per. So the riders can only compete in one class within their development level. For the example, a rider can in an introductory beginner level can only compete in the following classes, 1, 2, or 3, to ensure fair play, and the rider should not be entered in a class below their technical level. Celine, I'd like to go back to your last question about the sidewalkers. So within the guidelines, I'll just read it quickly. It says, leaders must lead from midway between the horse's shoulder and the head, using the outside hand to hold the rope at their outside hip, with their inside hand flat at their side and across the belly. So it goes into more details there. So if you want to reference the guidelines, it's within the guidelines.
Okay.
Thank you.
And let's see what else we have waiting for you. Okay. Are there dress codes for the volunteers?
We do not have dress codes for the volunteers. No. There's nothing in our guidelines, so.
But perhaps something to be considered for the future, but
for good sure. Point. And if you know what, it's definitely something that we can look at for the future, but I think we need to, it's fantastic that we have volunteers that help everybody out, so they're very supportive, and I believe that. We didn't have the volunteers, some of the programs won't run, so it's great that we have them.
So our next question comes forward with regards to when will people see the results for the July competition?
So the July results, I have them submitted to the competition. We have them, they're available. They are available online, so if the riders logs into their portal to review their entry, there you can find that online now. They've been approved. I'm just waiting for the EC communications department to send it out. There might be a little bit of a delay because when they go through translation, there's a bit of a delay, but I'm hoping by the end of the week or early next week, they will be posted.
Great. Okay, and I think we'd already answered this one. We had one question with regards to riders looking up their tests. Does the website retain their tests from previous years? So I believe that you had, in fact, answered that.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So one other question, Jamie Ann, are there any age restrictions?
No, we don't have age restrictions. So there is an age restriction for to become classified for athletes, but no, for anybody that wants to compete, it's there's no age.
Okay. And perhaps you can talk a little bit about how you go about calculating your high point at the end of the year. So how is that taking place, and perhaps explain a little bit about the weighing of the classes?
So I will reference the guidelines. So if within the guidelines, it has so there's a breakdown of the point situation. So for first, I do believe it's put in there. Bear with me for a second. I just will reference it. It is within our guidelines and we broke it down. So I believe first place they get 5 points. Second place is 4 points. And third place. So So first place is 5 points. Fourth is 4 points, and it goes down from there. So and they need to compete in with there's a certain number of competitions that they have. I believe it's 3 to be eligible. Yeah, 3 competitions to be eligible for high point championships. And then same thing for, we will accumulate for the high point riding centers as well. And then it's within the guidelines there with all the, how their points are calculated.
I believe that you had received, Jamie Ann, some questions online earlier by email. Perhaps you can address some of those for us, if you don't mind.
Yes, so the one question that I have is, can the same horse be used for different riders within different classes? And yes, horses may be shared with between riders. So for some programs that don't have, we do receive entries from the same horse on multiple riders. So definitely it is more than welcome. And I believe we went through this before. So if an athlete does not have access to online to submit their video submission, they can complete a waiver within Section 5 of the guidelines to allow their coach to submit their video, their entry on their behalf. The coach can go in and enter a couple of riders at one time. If they have a bunch of students and they want to go in and enter submit. And I think...
I have another one here for you as well, Jamie Ann, that's coming live from the floor. So if you've got a moment, I'll interrupt.
And then I'll have one last one.
Okay, so I know this talk is about dressage competitions, but will the coast-to-coast come back? So perhaps for those people who aren't familiar with what the coast-to-coast was, you could explain that and address their question, please.
So we will not be bringing coast to coast back. It was a decision, I believe, 2 years ago that our focus would be on the dressage, the C2C. It used to be coast to coast and C2C. So coast to coast was a multidiscipline para program that we ran, and it had jumping, reining patterns, and obstacle courses. That within about two years ago, we made an announcement that we'd be phasing it out. We have phased it out with a concentration on para dressage, only dressage within our competitions, online competitions. That being said, I do encourage athletes, riders, coaches to maybe provincial offices. We did approach them about maybe potentially offering that. I know BC Therapeutic, they are running a program right now for video competitions, and I do believe the stream that they're doing is a multidiscipline stream that they're doing. So, but yeah, unfortunately, we will not be bringing it back at this time. I have one more question here, Celine, that I can. So the one question that I have is, when should I try the next level or next test? So the question being, classes are divided up into different ability levels that aims for providing a fair, inclusive competition experience for everybody. They're designed to cater to various experience of riding abilities for competitors. We encourage that athletes work with their coach to choose the class that best suits their abilities. Riders are encouraged to compete at the highest ability of their current riding ability. So they can develop effective riding skills and enable at the highest level of their current riding ability. If the rider consistently performs well at the chosen level, such as consistently top three placings for the whole season, we encourage them to try maybe the next level, or maybe try freestyle, or try something a little bit. But it's something that it's a discussion with the coach and the athlete, what their comfort level is. If the rider performs at their chosen level and has suffered a setback, or if the rider is the horse has experienced a setback, they can return to the lower level that they were before. And that was the last question that I had online.
And guess what? Is this the same for graded athletes? Is another question that we have.
So if within the guidelines, so if an athlete is classified and they're not riding at their ability, at their classification grade, it's basically that is why the EC tests were created. They were created to get people comfortable. So not necessarily, once you're classified, it's the highest ability level. Not necessarily if you're classified, you're riding at that level. So we encourage people to ride the EC national tests that were developed to go through your, to get comfortable and then move on to your next, not necessarily you have to compete at your grade. And within the EC rules, the same thing is if you're working in the, you're competing in a bronze competition, that is as well, you don't need to be, you can compete in those national tests. You don't have to do FEI tests. You can do those national tests, and they're not, the EC national tests are not, you'll see within the guidelines, they're not, there's no grade attached. So it's walk tests. We had 3 walk tests, 3 trot tests, 3 canter tests. So you do at your ability, whatever you feel comfortable at. So if somebody's classified grade 5 and they are not cantering yet, or they're not just getting back, or what, we highly recommend that you use those EC tests, and that's why they were developed. They're developed to help the rider through their training levels once they get more comfortable and move on.
So I'll just see if we've got any more questions. If there are any more questions from the floor, I'd encourage you to submit them via the question and answer bar at the bottom of your screen. Is there a set arena size that the tests need to be ridden in?
So I would reference you to the guidelines as well. So within the guidelines, depending on what tests you are doing, I believe the EC national tests that were created, so the walk, trot, canter, they are in the 60 by, the smaller, 20 by 40. And then at the top of the test, they'll have the size of the arena that needs to be done.
And just for clarification purposes, we'll be clear that that's 20 by 40 meters, not feet, but 20 by 40 meters.
Thanks, Lynn.
No problem. So just to finish off, and I'll just allow the question and answers to remain open in case we have any last minute questions. But as you'll see on your screen right now, we have put up Jamie Ann's contact information. So jgoodfellow@equestrian.ca, or you can reach her via toll-free number at 1-866-282-8395. Extension 146. I should let everyone know that presently our office at EC is closed on Fridays. We are open from Monday through Thursday, and Jamie Ann would be happy to answer any more of your questions online. So Jamie Ann, thank you very much for going through a complicated process and making it very easy for us to understand this evening. And we do have one last question. For taping, is it best to just keep things aimed straight from the letter C, or have video taker follow rider when taping?
The videos that I, so myself, when I travel with the team, I do some videoing of the team, and also submitted videos to the judges and worked with the judges. It is best if the video, you follow the horse. So you have the horse and the rider in the full frame. If they can't It's best if you use a tripod, but if you can follow them around. If you set the tripod and just leave it right down center line, you're gonna miss the movements in the corners, and the judge will not be able to see those movements to judge. So it's best if you either tripod or not, but you follow the horse and rider around the arena so they're in a full frame within that. That was the ideal, so then the judge can see the horse and rider throughout the frame. Thank you.
So just to further clarify, the person videotaping would stay stationary in that position, similar to what a judge's box, or the judge would be in that judge's box. And as a head would turn, so will the video camera turn to capture that and try and stay as clear as possible. Most definitely, as Jamie Ann has stated, having a tripod's very useful to avoid handshaking or anything that might distort things, and keeping in mind the light and whatnot, all of that too can make it a little bit challenging at times for some of the videos to be seen. So just again, I'll just say to people, reference all the points that Jamie Ann had mentioned earlier in her tips and tricks.
Thank you, Celine. Yeah, thank you for pointing that out, for sure. So yeah, stationary, so you're not moving around, but the tripod, definitely, if you do have one, it helps, because your arm, 5-minute test, your arm gets a little bit tired afterwards. So, but thank you, Celine. Thank you, everybody, for joining us this evening. And if you have any questions that you think of afterwards, please send me to my email address or give me a call, and we will be posting this live webinar. So if there's anybody that was unable to attend, we'll share this. Thank you.
Thank you, Jamie Ann. Thank you, everyone. Have a wonderful evening.
Thanks. Take care.